Allora, è proprio lì dietro, come sapete, un volto che ha avuto un abbrivio nel grande schermo nel migliore dei modi con Francis Coppola e nel corso del tempo ha saputo raffinare il suo personaggio da erede di James Dean a volto problematico della comunità californiana fino addirittura a interpretare, a vestire i panni di uno dei più famosi scrittori della contemporaneità, Bukowski. Signore e signori, è con noi Matt Dillon. So, you should wear the ear cuff.
Buongiorno.
Buongiorno.
Buongiorno. What is this? Sì. Sì. Ho dimenticato tutti in italiano. So, bisogno.
Esatto. As usual, at the beginning it doesn't work, but slowly.
Do we need?
Yeah. No, because you know I have to talk in Italian because.
Okay. Well, it is really an honor for me to be here back in Taormina for this 60th anniversary of the Taormina Film Festival. This is my third time here in Taormina, and I was delighted to be coming back because I like this place so much. It's a wonderful city, and it's a very, really wonderful festival. And it's a festival. I think that Italy really needs this festival here in the South, you know?
We too. Okay. Okay. Try to select the right channel.
Yes, yeah.
Okay. Yes, esattly. Allora, inizierei proprio da questa cosa che ha detto poco fa. Ho visto che in passato, in un passato recente, hai detto che ti piacerebbe proprio girare in Italia, anche nel sud dell'Italia. Hai
sì.
Come amici.
Assolutamente. Yes. Sì.
Conosci anche registi italiani come Pappi Corsicato e Gabriele Muccino. Beh, naturalmente ci piacerebbe che ci dicessi qualcosa di più. Cos'è che ti attrae, al di là naturalmente il cibo, il sole, la luce? Qual è il tuo legame con l'Italia?
Well, let's see. What did you mention? Food? Sunshine? What else?
Beh,
the people, I think the greatest thing about Italy are the people. Here is very, very unique. The generosity of the people, you know, when you come here, the way that you're invited and made to feel at home, and I think that comes through. I think in the films, because for me, I think what's more interesting in stories are people, not things. And Italy has they've made some great films that are about people, whether Fellini, Vitelloni, a film I remember that I liked very much. You know, there's been so many great Italian films that are about the human condition. And I think that's why Italy is such a really great, there's so many great stories here.
Senti, quando ci siamo incontrati qualche anno fa a Roma, mi ricordo ancora perfettamente che tu dicesti questa cosa qui rispetto al tuo rapporto col cinema, che eri stato molto fortunato ad essere cresciuto insieme ai tuoi film. Tu hai iniziato un po' come l'erede di James Dean anni '80 e man mano naturalmente che la tua immagine, anche la tua vita e tu stesso crescevi, il cinema ti ha offerto sempre dei ruoli più complessi, no? Penso per esempio al personaggio negativo di Crash, al poliziotto un po' macio e anche così manipolatore, fino ad arrivare addirittura ad essere la proiezione di Bukowski. Da questo punto di vista possiamo dire che il fatto di essere cresciuto insieme ai tuoi film è stato anche una forma di privilegio.
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing, well, it's always about, like I said, it's always about character, mm-hmm. finding a good character to play, and they don't always have to be likable, mm-hmm. but they have to be engaging. You find a good character has to be somebody that I'm interested in playing or seeing on the screen. So I think that's the most important thing, not whether they're likable or not. That's not always so important. But, you know, I think I've also done other things. I mean, I like, for me, becoming an actor was not because I felt this desire to be in the spotlight. That's not why I did it. I think what I recognized early on was the ability to turn the mirror on the audience and reflect some truth about life, about people. And so that's what was always interesting to me about that. So I've also branched off at different times as a director and as a writer. Some things I've produced, some things I haven't. But and that's my interest in you know, bringing some sort of truth. If people can see themselves in the people that they see, in the characters, then that's what I think is powerful.
Ecco, la tua versatilità e anche la tua ambizione di non essere solo nel cinema come un attore, ma anche come regista e produttore, ne parleremo adesso. Però prima volevo farti un'altra domanda che riguarda la tua carriera nel passato. Tu parlavi prima del grande cinema italiano classico. Tu però hai avuto la possibilità di lavorare con grandissimi registi degli anni 70 come Francis Coppola e Arthur Penn, che hanno completamente rivoluzionato la Hollywood degli anni 50. Volevo chiederti, qual è la differenza tra il cinema americano di quegli autori e il cinema americano di oggi?
Well, I started acting at a very, you know, a long time ago. I was very young when I started, so I've actually watched the film industry go through transformations more than once, you know. I've seen it change, you know. I mean, look at the, you know, I mean, like, the planet is so different even since the last time I came to Taormina. You know, I was in a restaurant, I was looking, and I was in a restaurant, and the guy said, look, this is when you came to Taormina the first time, and I was wearing a wristwatch in the picture. And I was like, well, you're an exception, but people don't wear watches anymore because they have their cell phones. They just look on their cell phones now, you know? And so the world is changing all the time, and, you know, in the film industry, in terms of, you know, what's different now about movies the way they were made in the 70s. Well, I think when I first started acting, it was so important, you know, developing your craft for young actors. We took it very seriously, you know. Mm-hmm. I think there's less, I mean, unfortunately, there are very good films coming out all the time, but I think more and more films are more strictly about sort of entertainment, you know. There's a lot of, you know, films, there seems to be, I mean, television seems to be more, there seems to be more interesting stuff going on in television sometimes, you know, the writing and et cetera. So, you know, I think what, I'm interested in a cinematic experience when I go to a movie. I want to feel something that transports me, that takes me somewhere else and somehow, but it has to be truthful. And so I always look for that. And I think in the 70s, you know, I mean, listen, there was the old story, I think, there was the old thing that I think Paul Newman talked about, like the two biggest box office stars mm-hmm. in 19, I forget what year it was were two robots and a shark, right? Mm-hmm. And I was talking about Jaws and I think in Star Wars or something.
Star Wars, yeah.
Right, two robots and a shark were the, and so that changed things, you know, there. But I don't know.
Hai toccato il punto su cui, a cui volevamo arrivare, hai parlato appunto dell'importanza che oggi hanno le grandi serie televisive, nel senso che molte di queste hanno una scrittura, un investimento produttivo e anche una regia di grande qualità e personalità, più di quanto accada oggi al mainstream del grande schermo, del cinema. È uscita da qualche giorno la notizia che tu sei impegnato in una serie diretta da Michael Knight Shyamalan, che è uno dei registi più interessanti hollywoodiani. Ce ne puoi parlare?
Yeah, well, it was a limited series, meaning more like a mini series, you know. It wasn't like an ongoing thing with M. Night Shyamalan, who was the producer and director, as well as some other very good directors on it as well. Again, I think it's because I think the audience that maybe would go to that typically go to see the types of films that I want to see are often at home watching television. So there's more interesting stuff happening on television. The thing I did was called Wayward Pines.
Wayward.
And we had a great, terrific cast, you know, Melissa Leo and Carla Gugino and Toby Jones.
A sort of a supernatural.
No, I wouldn't say it's supernatural. It's more of an atmospheric kind of. It seems it's psychological drama, uh-huh. But then it turns into something more. There's elements of science fiction as well.
Ho letto che qualcuno citava Twin Peaks di David Lynch.
Yeah, well, that's good. I mean, that's nice that they say that, but I'd be very uncomfortable comparing anybody to David Lynch. I think it's almost impossible.
Senti, un'altra cosa che stupisce sempre, appunto, per preparare questo incontro, io e il mio staff abbiamo visto diversi film, eccetera. Mi stupisce molto come a un certo punto della tua carriera sei diventato molto convincente nella commedia. L'impressione è, rivedendo i tuoi film, che tu ti diverta molto a fare dei personaggi un po' scemi, diciamo così, no? A interpretare, diciamo, soprattutto in Tutti pazzi per Mary. Ma c'è stato un momento, che credo che faccia parte anche quello della crescita di un attore, in cui si ha l'impressione che tu improvvisamente scopra che potevi far ridere di te stesso.
Yeah, no, I do like doing comedy. I like to do it. I don't often get the chance to do it. I think the thing about, I don't feel the pressure to be funny because I didn't start up as a comedian. Mm-hmm. And so I don't feel that pressure to be funny. But comedy's great because I think what's really great, ironically, is that comedy is really all about the characters. It's all about, you know, human nature, you know? So you kind of really have to, you have to really apply yourself to the character. You really have to be, you know, you can't be lazy, you know. You really have to be, you have to find the truth in the character, because comedy is the truth, right? I don't get to do enough as much comedy as I'd like to, but there we go. Okay,
the same happened to Eva Longoria yesterday.
Okay.
It's a part of the script.
Beautiful, there we go. Part of the script.
Ma possiamo dire proprio su questa cosa, no? Noi abbiamo dato stamattina, per l'appunto, Factotum, in cui interpreti in realtà un personaggio romanzesco, proiezione dei romanzi di Bukowski. Però la cosa che è più interessante e sorprendente è che tu sia anche lì qualche piccolo tocco di comicità per dare più spessore al personaggio.
Yeah, well, I think Factotum was definitely a somewhat melancholy uh-huh. comedy, uh-huh. but it's a comedy, you know. And I think that director has very much a very interesting Norwegian filmmaker, Bent Hammer. He's very serious guy, mm-hmm. And like he did some things in the film I thought were really terrific, that were very very visual, very. Chaplin-esque, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a scene where we were walking and Lily Taylor's shoes were uncomfortable, and she takes off her shoes and I give her my shoes and we start to walk down the street. Mm-hmm. And I really liked that, and there's a lot of humor in it, and that humor comes from the truth of who those people were and the kind of, you know, deplorable conditions sometimes that they're living in. But I prefer that kind of comedy. I like comedy that's based in reality.
L'attività come regista, qualche anno fa quando sei venuto la seconda volta proiettammo a Taormina City of Ghosts. Prima ti volevo chiedere come ci si trova a stare davanti e dietro la macchina da presa, che è una cosa per esempio piuttosto comune nel cinema italiano, dove da De Sica a Germi, a tantissimi, a Nanni Moretti, spesso usano l'idea di essere attori di se stessi. Volevo sapere come ti hai ritrovato tu a fare il regista e anche l'attore. E secondo, volevo sapere se hai altri progetti come regista.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it's a good question because, you know, I directed a film that I also starred in, you know, and I had, prior to that, directed only a little bit, and I didn't have much experience. Certainly, I'd never directed myself. So the first thing I did was I went to an old acting coach of mine. I said, listen, man, I'm really concerned. What am I going to do? I said, well, you have to come with me to Cambodia, because I made the film in Cambodia. I said, I'm not going to... And he said, no, you got to trust yourself and, you know, to rely on the monitor, which is something I don't like to look at myself anyway, you know. But I got used to that. I think the key for me in making that film and directing and acting in it was to be prepared. Preparation was really everything. So preparation before we started shooting, for example. But also when I came to work every day, I had to be prepared as an actor first and a director second.
Un'ultima cosa, poi passiamo alla conferenza stampa con le domande dal pubblico.
Oh, just real quick, and the other thing you were asking about is director. Well, I've written some things, but I haven't produced anything else since then. But I'm in the process of doing a documentary.
Ah, su cosa?
About Afro-Cuban music.
Ah.
Again, it's the same thing you come up against. What's interesting in a film, in a story, are people, not things. So this is a story about a particular individual who was a brilliant talent, a Cuban singer who started in the late 40s. He was the first Cuban scat singer, como Ella Fitzgerald.
Singer.
Yeah, like very influenced by the American jazz of that mid period, and was one of the founders of the feeling movement in Cuba, which was, it started in the late 40s, and it was. Cuban music influenced by American jazz. So anyway, I went nearly over 10 years ago to Mexico City to film him while he was making a record with a friend of mine. And I put it down. I never did anything with all the footage. And then about a year and a half ago, I said, I want to do something with this. I opened it up and I've been just going back and forth. And what's different about documentaries than doing a feature film is that you can pick it up and you can put it down and pick it up again. And
come si chiama questo artista?
His name is El Gran Feove.
El Gran Feove.
The Great Feove, which was the nickname that was given to him. He, like many Cubans of the time in the late 40s and the 50s, they had to go to Mexico to seek fortune and fame and success because there was more of an infrastructure there. Mm-hmm. And Mexicans were very, very receptive. They had a very booming film industry and they invited, and music industry, and they invited many Cubans and a lot of Cubans. They needed to go to Mexico to make it first. Paris Prado, the Mambo, was all born in Mexico.
Per cui Buñuel ha lavorato per molti anni lì.
Absolutely, exactly.
Quando ci vediamo a Roma, io mi ricordo parlammo a lungo della tua passione per il jazz, per la musica, quindi c'era già, diciamo, tu sei un esperto conoscitore della musica jazz.
I'm not an expert, I'm just an enthusiast, somebody who likes music. I feel that way about music across the board. In fact, well, I mean, yeah, I mean, some of I mean, like, for example, the documentary I'm making really is just about, it's as much about my passion as in filmmaking mm-hmm. as it is about my passion for that music.
Ok, allora, apriamo, volevo chiamare Tiziana a darmi una mano con... Vabbè, qualcuno la chiamerà. Intanto, ci sono delle domande? Eccola.
Tiziana, Tiziana.
Thank you for coming.
Tiziana. Ok.
Aspetta, aspetta per il... Eccola.
Benata mattina. Sì, vicino. Emozionata. Comunque, una domanda banale, ma che mi interessa. Questo mettere al centro l'uomo, questo suo interesse per le vicende personali, è molto bello. Da cosa nasce?
I think it's because, honestly, I believe, it's not that I believe this, this is just a fact, that, you know, people tell stories, you know, stories come from people, and it's not the other way around, you know? And so I think that's what comes first. I have a very good friend of mine who's a screenwriter, a veteran screenwriter, and he tells me, I tell all my students, he said, the first thing that I tell them is when they start talking about the structure of the story. He just says, keep working on the characters, just keep building the characters, keep creating the history of the characters. And the truth is, you know, because that's what's interesting, people and our experiences. And every story, I mean, as I'm learning and making a documentary about a man's life, is that every story is almost a perfectly constructed screenplay in a weird way. Every human story, every life is that kind of a story.
Grazie, ogni vita.
A metà sala.
Buongiorno, Antonella Gurrieri della RAI. Lei ha detto che è importante, e lei è un portatore sano di verità. Vuole raccontare le verità. Quale verità italiana, se potesse, vorrebbe raccontare?
Well, there's so many stories here. It's really interesting, you know. We Americans love Italy, you know, we really do. And we have a fascination with this country. And yet my Italian friends all want to come to America, you know. I'm like, ah. Or they're in New York and they have to go back to Rome, you know. And they go, I don't want to go back. I want to stay here. And I'm like, listen, everybody here wants to go and hang out in Italy, you know. And it's a wonderful, there's many great stories here, but there's also a lot of irony and humor, like being in a beautiful, fast Italian sports car in streets that you can't drive on because they're too narrow for sports cars, too many cobblestone streets. You know, I always think that this kind of stuff is funny, but what's wonderful about Italian filmmakers is they recognize the irony in their own society. You know, and those are the best Italian films, as Fellini did.
Ah, we get to speak in your mother tongue. You love grit after just capturing the film that we just saw again today, and I saw your film with the lovely Naomi Watts recently.
Sunlight Junior.
Yeah. You, the character kind of the same, not a lot of arc there. I realized in your last conversation that you said that you really like to get into the character and you're attracted to the character, obviously. When you have a part like what we just saw, Do you sometimes really want to embrace the light at all? Because there is not a lot of arc in both of those films, but yet they're compelling.
Well, you know, I think when you're, it's interesting that you point out both of those films, and they're both, they're very different, but I think, well, I think an arc is really important. I think, but let's talk about what that means. I mean, there are people that say, oh, I don't want to play a character unless he goes, the character goes from through a transformation, you know? But I think that when we change as human beings, it's slower. It's usually not quite as dramatic as something that you see in a film structure. So I think what's more interesting, or what is what I discover about the character as you go. You know, sometimes it's, I mean, for example, you mentioned the film I did, Crash. I did this film, and this character goes through this epiphany, you know, where he discovers something in himself. We get that sense. And I think all the characters in that film did. And that was the strength of that film. However, there are other characters in storytelling, which is about what is revealed about that person, what we discover about that person. But that person doesn't necessarily change. That person is who that person has always been. But it's what we discover about them, which is what I think is interesting. Sometimes if I watch a film and I go, wow, I thought this character was this, but there's more there. Anyway, but in this film Factotum, I mean, for me, I read Charles Bukowski when I was like 19, 20 years old, and I liked all the irreverent humor, the drunken debauchery, the kind of, you know, the irreverence of that character, you know? I think when I read him at age 40, before doing this, I looked at him differently. I saw a vulnerability, and I started to embrace his poetry. And I thought that there was a whole other side, a whole other sensitivity to him, and that he wasn't just somebody who, he actually did care. He did have ambition, you know, in his life. He had desire to be different, and that was to be a successful writer, which is what I think that story was about. So my own personal discovery about him was really interesting. Reading him 20 years after I first had read him, where I responded to one thing, and then reading him later, where I really saw a real vulnerable man, a more of a sensitive person, you know? It was more multi-dimensional to me.
Ecco, ma per rendere più chiaro quello che hai detto adesso, il personaggio di Crash, no, è un personaggio molto squadrato, no? Però la bellezza di quel personaggio è che, pur restando identico, a un certo punto è capace di un gesto, quello di salvare la vita di un'altra persona, che non ci si aspetterebbe da lui. Cioè, l'idea è che un personaggio negativo è tanto più convincente quando c'è qualcosa, in qualche maniera, che nella sceneggiatura ne rende verosimile l'obiezione, il fatto che possa essere diverso.
Yeah, I think what I was trying to say there was that, I mean, it's done with finesse, but I think the idea is that we sense that character has changed, mm-hmm, at the end of the film, right? Sì. He carries himself a certain way. By the end of the film, he's a different person. Like, he discovers something within himself, the hero that's inside of him, rather than, and really, I think that's why he became a policeman in the first place, was because he felt he wanted to do something, make, you know, and that's what he discovers in the end about himself, instead of this guy who's really bitter and disillusioned. Now, my point was that sometimes a character, I think there's a, look, in dealing with producers and dealing with, development executives, when you're creating a character, or when in screenplays, there's a lot of focus put on the arc of the character. And my point is more that I think what's interesting in the real work is finding out who the person is before you have the person change, to bring that character to life so it's there. And as an actor, sometimes we have to do all that background work, you know? We have to give that character a history, you know? And I think that's important. That's the arc, is what we discover about that person, you know? What that person reveals, you know? Oh, there's another side to that person. Oh, I didn't realize that. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that's where the arc is, you know? That's in the story shapes that. Not necessarily, I find that sometimes it seems fake to me mm-hmm. when a character goes, oh, and they discover something new about themselves. And I think that's not my approach. I'd rather the character be who he is. It's not so important that he discovers something about himself. Is that I discover something about him and the audience discovers something about him as we go. Oh, because we are very complex, you know, human beings.
Mario, volevo fare una domanda io. Siccome Matt Dillon è il terzo anno che viene a Taormina, quindi conosce molto bene Taormina e il festival, volevo capire da lui l'emozione di essere comunque al 60° anniversario del festival di Taormina.
Well, you know, I have to say, you know, coming here, this place, you know, I've probably not spent more than a couple weeks here if I bring it all together, you know, in Taormina, but it brought back a lot of memories just coming back to this city, and it reminded me of when I had come here, I think the first time was in 1999, I think, and Enrico Ghezzi at the time was running the film festival. You know Enrico,
of
right?
Course.
Probably an old
together,
colleague yeah. of yours, who a yeah. man I admired very much and really liked him. And you know, it's. I have very fond memories of coming here and visiting Noto and Siracusa, and it's a very evocative place. I mean, this place stays with you, I think, and I think it's important. And I applaud you for doing this, for keeping this festival going, you know. I think it's important. I think this festival can be one of the most important festivals. I think it's really a special place. I think the challenge for people is how do you go inside of a dark movie theater when it's so beautiful outside, right?
Yes.
When the weather's so nice and it's such a nice city. And, you know, but I guess the trade-off is that you do it in this beautiful Colosseum at night, right? Is it a Colosseum or is it a arena?
Arena.
The arena is very nice. So, anyway, I'm just delighted to be back here.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Un altro paio di domande. Ecco, Simonetta.
No, io mi domandavo, lui è la seconda volta che cita Fellini in 20 minuti, 25. Però è un signore che segue molto l'Italia, come ci sta ripetendo anche adesso. E i nostri autori italiani di adesso, uno ha pure vinto l'Oscar, mi vengono, tanto per dire, i due David Virzì e Paolo Sorrentino. Li conosce o non li conosce?
No, in realtà abbiamo
yes.
accettato.
Well, I only know his most recent film, The Great Beauty, which I thought was a really powerful film. I think it was really... Really, I thought it was an amazing film, and I thought it was truthful. But I mean, I think it was so specific, really, to Italy. But I think, on a more universal sense, it talked about, you know, our convictions in life. Here we have this character who is an author who wrote this book that was this great yes. moment in his life, but he never.
But it's Fellinesque too.
What?
It's Fellinesque in a way.
Fellini-esque?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, it has mm-hmm. a lot of that. But I mean, the idea that this guy. At a certain point in his life, it's his 65th birthday, decides, you know, I'm not going to waste my time doing things that I don't want to do anymore. And I think we all have that feeling at times, whether we're 65 or whether we're 15, you know. And but I thought it was a beautifully made film, and I think it captured, you know, I mean, it was. I think it was a very deep film.
Comunque forse Simonetta non eri ancora arrivata, ma ha citato all'inizio Pappi Corsicato e Gabriele Muccino, che sono due registi con cui ha che conosce.
Yeah, no, Pappi's a friend too. He's a friend, yeah. From Naples.
Maria Lombardo della Sicilia. Desidero sapere, visto che da giovanissimo hai esordito con Coppola, ecco, cosa ti ha insegnato il grande Francis Ford Coppola? E poi una cosa di attualità, qual è il prossimo film nel quale ti vedremo sullo schermo?
No, no, scusate, c'era prima la persona dietro.
Yeah, the question about Coppola. When I worked with Francis in 1982, I think, yes. he was practically a deity, you know, kind of a god to us young actors. You know, really, we all were really were in awe of him, and we all wanted to work with him, and. So that was really kind of a big deal to work with him. But what I think I got from, I don't know, Francis really gave me a great boost of confidence as a young actor, I think, you know? And he was also very impulsive, spontaneous kind of a personality. So. For example, when we were doing The Outsiders, it was while we were in the middle of making that film that he decided, I want to do another film based on this author's book called Rumblefish, like immediately. And that was pretty unheard of, I think, just to decide to make a movie, you know, that we're going to make another film in 2 months. We'll get the script written and we'll make this film right back to back. And we made those films back to back. And they couldn't have been more different in terms of the atmosphere and style of those films. I mean, one of them was made, and I think that's one of the things I learned from Francis too, was that his reverence toward the history of cinema is very evident, you know? Like when we made, and he used to say things like, you know, good artists steal, you know.
Yes.
Bad artists borrow, or something like that. I might be getting that one wrong.
Uno si ispira a Kazan, l'altro alla Nouvelle Vague, completamente.
One's what?
Rumblefish looks like a Nouvelle Vague film in a way. It's experimental, and the other one, Outsider, is like.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, but one of the things in the book, in the book of The Outsiders, they reference Gone with the Wind. So Francis said, I want this to be a real Technicolor old movie, like an old Hollywood movie. And it feels very much like a movie that, even though it was made in the 80s, it could have been made in the late 50s, you know? It has that kind of big cinematic Technicolor feeling to it. But when he did Rumblefish, he was more interested in doing an art film, doing something that was more personal to him. And, you know, as you see, he dedicated that film to his brother, Augusto. So, and it was a film about brothers. And I think that's one theme you can see often with Francis in his movies is family, brotherhood. And so that film was done all in black and white, but he always had cinematic references, you know, I think, you know, like I said, Gone with the Wind, or in Rumblefish, there was a lot of stuff to, you know, this is like Carol Reed, like The Third Man or something, you know, the shot, you know. And, but he was always technologically ahead of everybody. So when we did Rumblefish, for example, I remember this is 1982, and at that time, people really weren't working in the digital medium yet at all, but we did the entire film in a rehearsal process on a green screen. On video, we shot the whole movie in rehearsal. I remember it was friggin' hot. It was like 110 degrees, and we're in a gymnasium in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Dennis Hopper and Mickey Rourke and Nicolas Cage and Lawrence Fishburne were all like
Tom Waits.
Tom Waits. We had quite a cast, you know, and it was very different. And of course, Diane Lane, who was in both films as well, but. It was a very different kind of experience.
Ti chiedeva anche se c'è un progetto di film, feature film che
Yeah, well, you know, I'm always, like I said, I finished this limited series, this television thing, it's interesting, called Wayward Pines, but I had, I'm working on this documentary, and that's really, I have to tell you, it really it's fascinating, you know, to look at storytelling, you know, for documentary filmmaking. I have never done that before. But the discovery is, I mean, really, when you're doing a documentary, you're writing it as you're editing it, in a way. You're discovering the story as you're editing it. There's a thing about filmmaking, they say you write the film when you write it, then you write it when you shoot it, and then you write it when you edit it. Well, that's really true in documentaries. You know, that's really true.
Una frase di Rivetta. Prego.
Ciao.
El Gran Feove, that's the documentary.
El Gran Feove.
Ciao, io sono una giovane attrice che si è appena diplomata al Centro Sperimentale di Cinematografia. Che
è la scuola
a Roma. Volevo chiederle, e visto che in questo momento ci sono tantissimi giovani disorientati, anche avendo un diploma, avendo già fatto delle cose, lei che ha iniziato giovanissimo ed è arrivato fino a qui, che farebbe qualcosa per i giovani e se sì, che cosa farebbe portando la sua esperienza? Grazie.
Well, that's a really good question that you ask, and I do feel like when I do work or talk to young people or work with young people that it's important for me to, you know, I'm a veteran now. I don't like to think of myself as a veteran. I still like to think of myself as a young kid running around. But in fact, I have a lot of experience, and I like to be able to talk about that, and because I learn a lot. I mean, if I stop being a student, then I should just give it up, you know? I mean, I feel like I have a lot to learn myself. But, you know, I encourage always young people to be, you know, to embrace all creative, you know, crafts and develop and work on other things. I mean, like I said, for me, because my experience, like I said, I did not feel this need to be a performer. That's not why I became an actor. I like performing. I'm comfortable doing it. I'm comfortable with accessing emotions as an actor. I like all that. But what really was powerful to me was to turn the mirror on people so they could see something that resonates as truth to them. So the word that is my favorite word recently is verisimilitude. Now, how do you say that in Italian? Verisimilitude.
Verosimiglianza.
Yes. So it's the approximation of truth.
Yes. Yeah. Likeability.
Verisimilitude. It is the appearance of truth. It's not truth. It's not, we make films, we're playing a character. We're not showing you. But that brings out very real truth, true feelings in somebody. So it's a powerful thing. But you can be creative. You don't have to just, I always tell young actors, write. You know, and I tell, I think it's a good idea for young directors. You know, a lot of directors don't know anything about acting. And they don't know anything about it. So I encourage them, take an acting class. You know, study acting, you know, actors, we're good storytellers. So we should write, you know, as well. I think we should write. We read more. Often actors are some of the best read people. I know a lot of people that didn't finish high school that are really well read, you know.
Ma parlando di verosimiglianza, come lavorare con Michael Knight, Shyamalan, che è considerato un po' lo Spielberg dei giorni oggi?
Well, his name's not Michael Shyamalan. Michael? M. Knight. M. Knight Shyamalan.
M. Knight.
Yeah, M. Knight. But is it Michael? I didn't think it was Michael. Is that what the M stands for? I didn't know. Michael. Anyway. Okay. He's a very, very good storyteller. Really good, I think. I was very impressed with him as a director, you know. He had command. He was a good leader. He had good leadership skills and very intelligent. Had really, you know, good ideas. And was very a good storyteller.
Bene, siamo in conclusione. Abbiamo anche un po' sforato rispetto al tempo previsto. Ringraziamo Matt Dillon di essere stato qui con noi.
Thank you. Thank you.